Well, look how good she looked then, and look how good she looks today. Hasn't changed a bit. Still gorgeous. After all these years, here's her husband, Ringo Starr. Hey, this is the welcome I'm looking for when I get off the Concord. What a wonderful thing. Still young, still sober after all these years.
That's the truth.
He's here because he's crazy about me. But also because he wants you to know he's in concert, along with a lot of other very, very talented people opening this week at Radio City Music Hall. This is a world tour. Well, Ringo Starr, first things first here. You have reunited, and it will be part of a documentary which airs this fall. John, Paul, and you.
And George.
And George. This is merely a studio. You got together quietly, and you did some things for the documentary.
Yeah. It's our version of what the Beatles were really like, because we know better than anyone else.
But you're serious that there were, because of the juggernaut, there were certain things we didn't understand about you, I assume you feel.
Well, I think the good thing about this, finally, is that we're sitting around telling you what we felt it was, what it was about. You know, I mean, there's so many people out there telling everyone what they thought it was, and people begin to believe that. So now you'll finally hear the three of us, and John also in...
On film.
On film and audio, you know, interviews he'd done before, telling it like we felt it was like.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't want you to step on this magnificent television event that will happen this fall. I believe ABC is airing it.
ABC is airing it. Yeah.
Uh-huh. But what is? Give us a kernel of what it. Some of the things that we didn't understand that you set the record straight about. You don't have to tell us the whole thing. Just,
yeah. Well, yeah. I think mainly it's about the times in the studio. How songs had changed that nobody knew about the life that the four of us had to lead. We were on 24 hours a day, really. Mm-hmm. Where from the minute we opened our eyes, somebody wanted to get at us for something. Mm-hmm. And we ended up, the story is like we take the whole floor of a hotel, and we four of us would be sitting in the toilet. And it was for other reasons in the 60s. It was the only place we could sort of get away from the pressure, because the mm-hmm. pressure was on as soon as you opened your eyes. So, yes. Oh, sign this, say this, do this, blah, 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 give me. And so we try and get some space.
But what is remarkable that when we see the bones of the superstars who could not handle, may we just name two, Janis Joplin,
sure,
and Elvis.
Yeah.
Your survival, sure, and your clear eye today, along with the surviving Beatles,
yeah,
is a remarkable thing. We should hesitate to applaud people for civil behavior, yeah, but the odds were against you.
Well, you see, the great thing I've always felt is that there were four of us. And at certain moments in time, individually, we all went mad. I mean, I remember my phase of really just starting to crack up and believing that I was, the biggest thing on the planet, 5'7". And, and just the madness and the crazy, you start believing that, you're all this God thing. And so as soon as I'd get into that, the other three would be like, what do you say? What do you mean?
In other words, you
we'd
each
help
were...
each other down, because you'd get crazy with it all, and then mm-hmm. the other three would bring me down. If it was George, then we'd all look at him, and if mm-hmm. it was John, we'd look at him. Excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
So that, I feel, was the lifesaver. With mm-hmm. Elvis, I feel it was very sad because though he had people around him, he was surrounded when I met him, anyway, with sycophants that, whatever he said, they said okay. You know, so if he said, okay, we're going to jump out the window, they'd say, oh, okay, boss. They'd all dive out with him. You know? And no one was sort of saying, like, cool out.
So the Beatles had no guru snapping fingers. You had whatever.
Each other. That's what we had. More than anything, we had each other. Mm.
You were a waiter on a ferry from Liverpool to Wales as a kid?
Yeah, I worked in the Merchant Navy. I wanted to go deep sea. That just means you go to really foreign countries. But Wales, if anyone knows England, is just around the corner. But it was great for at night for picking up girls because they'd think I was a sailor. And they'd say, I'd say, oh, I've just come back, you know, I've just got off the ship. And they'd say, well, when did you leave? And I'd say, 10 o'clock this morning.
Get out of here.
We have some film of Down Memory Lanes, which we'll watch here in just a moment. The point should be made that you found yourself with no more Beatles unit, with several million dollars and a place in Monte Carlo. Where does a guy go from here? I know this is my question, and no, you're not asking for any telethons, and it's awfully hard for so many people looking for work to feel sorry for you in that circumstance, but it had to be weird.
Sure.
Nothing, I assume at the beginning, you must have gotten up in the morning.
Sure, you got up
with
in the
nothing
morning.
To do.
That's right. You wonder what to do with yourself. Because, you know, it's like anyone, if you go into the office for 10 years, you go to the office, you know that route, and then suddenly you're fired, then you're wondering what to do with yourself. It was the same for me. We'd split up. And suddenly, I didn't have that job. Mm-hmm. And I was really confused. I wondered what to do with myself, you know. I wasn't the main writer. They had all the rights. And I didn't know what to do. And then, of course, you know, in the end, you pick yourself up. I called George Martin. I said, I'd like to make a record. And I made a record of all the music I'd heard from my family. That started me, and then, I did a country album, and then with Richard Perry, we made the Ringo album, which was, you know, I had a couple of number ones off that. Mm-hmm. So I was back on the roll, you know, but at the beginning it was, I just was confused.
Yes, but with all that money, after all that hard work, and it was, you had to hit your mark, the concert was on, no matter how you felt, you made the date, but you did what not a few other people would do on the planet Earth under these circumstances. You drank.
Sure.
What else, huh? Oh.
What would you do if your show went off?
Well, what's it going to be like?
I did. You can see.
What's it going to be like? Give me some free advice here.
Well, it gets tough, I'll tell you.
I mean, do you look at the clock?
No, you don't look at the clock. I mean, you can see my career. I mean, you know, we were talking about, I did the album with George Martin and ended up with the Ringo album, which was a big hit, and then the Goodnight Vienna album. And then you watch my career really just fall into the pit. And because I was, I was using and abusing anything I could find and not taking care of anything. I just was not involved. I was making records because that's what I did. So I would sort of get to the studio, but the only thing I wanted to do was leave and party, and then I would get to the studio and party. So it was just, it was a gradual thing over 10, 15 years. I mean, it didn't happen overnight. Mm-hmm. It just went down and down and down until I hit the bottom and then started to come up again. Mm-hmm.
Your rehab experience was in the United States, is that so?
Sure, yeah.
And be about how many weeks would this be? Just kind of
5 weeks.
Boy, that had to be, the first week had to be a year and a half long.
I don't know what the first week was like. Yeah. The second week, they used to say, you'd go to a lecture or something, and they'd say, all the people who were here last week, put up your hand. And they'd say, no, you were here. I didn't know.
Yeah.
I didn't know, but thank God, and thank the people there. They hugged me and loved me and taught me things about myself, and so far, things are looking good.
So there's been no relapse?
Not yet, no. Not today.
One day at a time. That's right. Respect the problem. So from the inside, then, you have a whole new change in... it's not just not drinking, it's...
It's living. It's living, it's being there, you know, it's being there for other people. You know, the crazy thing I did when I sobered up, you know, these all these strange thoughts come into your brain, and one of them was, what do I do? And I'm sitting there, and then this light goes up and says, oh, you're a musician. Oh, yeah, I'm a musician, that's right. Well, no, I play drums. And, well, what do you do? Well, you play with people. And that, so then, I put a band together and did what I do best, and that's go out and play to the people and make music.
Well, you are... I wasn't there when she said it. I don't know if this is apocryphal, but it certainly sounds like it's how she felt. She said, Janis Joplin said, I made love to 40,000 people tonight, and I went home alone. Now, you, in this book by Max Weinberg, which is a review of the Big Beat, it's titled The Big Beat, Bruce Springsteen forwarded. He was, as you know, his drummer. Now, your pal. He quotes you here saying that you were a little kid trapped inside this press conference and all these people and people fainting and screaming. You were frightened.
Sure. Oh, yeah, a lot of it wasn't easy. I remember the London Palladium, which was the early days, but that was the big thing to do. And I remember London Palladium and there they are. And I was sick in a bucket backstage and then came on to do it. And I was nervous. I'm a pretty shy person. And so it wasn't easy all the time. Mm-hmm. And then, I didn't tour. It's different in Max's book to how it is now, because that was done in 1984 or 5. He'll tell us when he comes on. My own career was going downhill, but it was pretty scary. On stage with the Beatles was exciting to be on stage with the Beatles. But, what was coming at us was very strange. Because what was coming at us was like this wall of sound and this mania. So, you just have to say good evening, and then, if we could imagine, let's all do this, shall we?
Yeah.
On the count of three, I want you all just to scream your brains out.
And I'll sing.
And you just say thank you.
All right.
Ready? This is what it was like.
All right.
One, two, three. Now, if you can imagine that for 30 minutes. That was very strange.
You had to look at your musicians, your three pals, to even begin to understand where they were.
Well,
on the page.
Oh, I didn't know off the time where we were. We were just guessing. And you'd notice some, shrug, and you say, oh, we're up to that verse. okay.
Now.
Well, sometimes, if you watch the footage, there's someone will go... Because I'm playing another song.
Yes.
Nobody knew because you had this 1, 2, 3.
Yeah!
Thank you.
They weren't quite so deep as that.
Yeah. Just a couple more before we break here. The head of a drummer. What's inside the head of a drummer? This is very interesting. I'm very instructed by what you said.
What's inside the beat?
Except there's a sort of second-classness. The drummers...
Are you asking me or what?
Back there, I'm...
You're telling me now.
You told me?
Yeah, I told you. God, you say the things once in your life, it's held against you.
It is true, though.
It is true. The drummers are always they're always at the back, so they're always put at the back. But for me personally, coming to America was great because they love drummers in America. America's great for drummers. They just have this feel for them. They like drummers. It was just amazing. Suddenly I arrive in America and everyone's saying Ringo, Ringo, suddenly. Where in England it was John Paul, George, and Ringo. And here it could be in any order, so it was really great.
Yeah. Is it ready?
Is it
the
ready?
The year is 1964. Who's going to forget? Where were you? When this crowd appeared.
Weren't even born.
I'll say. 1964.
Especially you.
And here he is, introducing the Beatles, Ed Sullivan Show. Beatles Come to America.
Ladies and gentlemen, the screams herald the appearance on our show of the Beatles.
That's funny edit, but let's, just a couple of things in there.
I'll break it.
Does Michael Jackson own the tapes and the
keys? No, he owns nothing. He owns the publishing.
And that's nothing?
Well, he doesn't own me. You know what I'm saying? He doesn't own me. Publishing, so if anyone of the audience there go out and do a Beatles song, I mean, he gets paid on the publishing. Mm-hmm. They get paid on the record, and he gets the publishing. Mm-hmm.
And why wouldn't Ringo or George or Paul own the publishing? Just didn't happen.
I own Octopus's Garden.
That's all that matters.
That's all that matters.
You did say that, and I know this is a story that. Certainly been published before, but Paul was doing his solo thing, writing. John was writing, and you thought you were the fourth man out. That George and the other three would collaborate, and that you were. And yeah. You said, "I quit."
Yeah, on the White Album, I thought those three were getting on real well, and I wasn't playing well, and I wasn't getting on with these three. And so I went, I sort of went around to John's. Hello. You three are getting on real well. You know, I feel left out. And he says, I thought it was you three. So then I went to Paul, in case I was just going mad. And, Paul, I feel you three are really getting on, and I feel left out. And he says, I thought it was you three. So I said, well, I'm going on holiday. I'm getting out of here. So I went on. I just left and went away.
But the...
When you do that, we'd been together for years, so you go through, really in together, and then one of them's like a satellite that detaches for a while and comes...
I know, but you came home, and they wanted you home, and they put flowers in your room when you got home.
Yeah, George did the whole studio in flowers, and John was sending me telegrams.
Well, that's a lovely thing, isn't
it? That's a fabulous thing. Well, that's what brothers do.
And that's how you think of yourself today.
Sure, I still think we were the Four Musketeers.
And we'll be back with Ringo Starr. You had the most... I'm sorry?
Sounded just like me.
Yes, Ringo, I would like to ask you, were you married during all those early years?
Yes.
Are you still?
Not to the same woman. This is my lovely bride over there.
I just wanted to dispel the myth that the Rolling Stones were the original bad boys of rock. This is an album they did 30 years ago. It was briefly released by Capitol. I peeled the cover off, and this is pretty avant-garde for the time, 30 years ago.
I tell you, it is. These are dolls.
That's the
Beatles yesterday and today.
Yeah. It seemed like a good idea at the time.
I graduated high school in 64, so you can imagine what kind of fan I was, or still am. I want to know what your parents thought when y'all left the country and went traveling like you did.
I think the hardest thing for my mother was when I left Liverpool. After that, she didn't really mind.
You're an only child, so this had to be...
I'm an only child. Well, she also felt that, drumming was okay as a hobby.
Ringo, I want to thank you for being one of the few constant presences in my life for the past 31 years, as I'm sure is true for many of us here. And it really warms my heart to see the reaction of the younger generation to you and your music and the magic of Ringo and the Beatles. I'd like to know how you feel about this and how you would explain it.
Well, I can only explain it by saying that the music was really good. We did make a lot of good records, and that's what's up front all the time. It's quite nice, actually, to hear bands. You can hear the influences, the influences of the Beatles. Well, if you listen to our early stuff, of course, you can hear the influences of Little Richard and Chuck Berry and all those other guys. So the beat goes on,
We're very glad that you did.
Hold on 1 second, please. Lots of folks with
questions. You're only allowed one question, I'm afraid.
We'd like to get on as many as we can. Sir.
Ringo, did you and the other Beatles ever think in your wildest dreams that when you landed here in 1964... at Idlewild Airport, you would change a music world forever?
No, I don't think that's what we were thinking then. I don't think we got off the plane and said, hey, we're going to change the music world. It's not something that sort of comes right into your head.
Yes. Most of your musical heroes were your father's age when you were a kid.
Yeah.
Until
Elvis, actually. He was the first one. I came in with Frankie Lane and Johnny Ray and... Gene Autry, and then, of course, Gene Autry is one of my heroes. Mm-hmm. When I was eight, he knocked me out like the Beatles knocked some of you out. Mm-hmm. And then Elvis came, you know, he was a couple of years older, so that was just fabulous. Mm-hmm. He turned my head around. He was the king, you know.
Ringo, I've seen the last couple of All-Star tours, and I'm looking forward to the new one. It should be great. You must have a heck of an address book. How do you come up with the bands that you do to go on these tours?
Well, I have a very good address book, and that's a very nice tie. And that's what I do, I think. Well, you know, the tour I put on, you know, you have to have hits from sometime this century. And I think of people, and I think what sort of combination. And we call them up and see if they'd like to have fun through the summer. And the ones that say yes, we go on tour together. That's how I come up with it.
Your all-star band includes Randy Bachman of Bachman Turner Overdrive. Mark Farner.
Seen nothing yet.
Mark Farner, Grand Funk Railroad, yeah. Billy Preston, Felix Cavalier, and the Young Rascals, John Entwistle of The Who. Yeah. And on the drums, a young man getting better reviews than his old man got. I speak of his son, Zach, on the drums. Well, now. The All-Star Band. We'll be back in just a moment.
I'd like to know if there's a chance that you and Paul and George would ever get back together and perform a live concert.
The doggone Beatles show.
Yeah. Did you get cynical at all? Peace, love, imagine there's no country, nothing to live or die for. You know, you read the headlines today, where are we? So what's happened to your political soul here throughout this experience?
I've never really been political. I've been a musician.
You didn't hope for?
Oh, yeah. I loved the 60s and flower power, and we felt that, you know, peace and love. I mean, that's still my act today, is peace and love. If that's political, that's how political I get. Mm-hmm. You know, it's still the dream, and it can still happen. You know, world peace is still a chance, as long as we all want it. And, you know, we don't have to injure each other. We can love each other.
I was wondering if you feel the responsibility of musicians as role models has changed since you've been a Beatle?
I don't think so. But I don't honestly believe that, you know, that should be laid on musicians as these role models. We're out there just like everyone else, and, you know, we're as varied as everyone else. So it's not like the job is to be this image for them that should be. I don't think that's what we should be doing.
Hi, Ringo. I'd like to know if there's a chance that you and Paul and George would ever get back together and perform a live concert.
I don't think so. I can't see it. I might as well say no, actually, because if I waffle at all, that's all I'll get for the rest of the tour. Well, are you getting back together? Well, the answer is no.
Mm-hmm.
No.
But we are impressed with your work ethic. I mean, you work for a living.
Sure.
But obviously, because you want to.
Sure. Well, we all work for a living. I mean, Paul's a workaholic. You know, he always has been. He's always doing something. I mean, you know, we can't just sit there for the rest of our life saying, oh, we did that. You know, I mean, this is what we do.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Hi. We know that Zach tours with you. How's Jason? How's Lee? And you have grandchildren, too?
Sure do. Well, Jason's fine. I had dinner with him last night in London. He's doing well. My daughter's okay. She's in California. And my granddaughter's got a cold.
Well,
and she's cool too.
Say, Beatles, what do you think of besides great music, 20th century figures in American popular culture, and hair? Watch this. Press conference time.
You still got the cut there, Phil.
Does all that hair help you sing?
What?
Does all that hair help you sing?
Definitely, yeah.
Do you feel like Samson? If you lost your hair, you'd lose what you have? It?
I don't know.
No, I don't think so.
How many are bald that you have to wear those wigs?
All of us.
I'm bald.
You're bald?
Oh, we're all bald, yeah. I'm deaf and dumb, too.
In a moment, the man who was Bruce Springsteen's drummer during the heydays of the E Street Band, as well as now seen nightly on the Conan O'Brien Show. I speak of Max Weinberg. You're the man. You served as his role model, and we'll talk to him when we get back here in just a moment.
Donahue's going doggone crazy.
Look at this beautiful animal.
Doing something they shouldn't have been doing? If so, give us a call at 1-800-205-7445. That's 1-800-205-7445.
There's the late night Denison, now working the Conan O'Brien program. Here's a young man who saw a Ringo Starr on the Ed Sullivan Show in 1964. He was 12 years old at the time. And he said, that's what I want to do. Holy cow, you get a spotlight on you, you make all this noise and have a blast. What he certainly did with Bruce Springsteen from 1974 to 1989. Here is a man who grew up to be almost as big as you, Ringo. I speak of Max Weinberg, one of the most respected drummers in our business. You saw him and you said, I want to do this. All of a sudden, wham, you're at the center of the universe with the boss. And that's a long time.
Yeah, it was 15 years.
And then the band breaks up and you go right to see Ringo. Is this about how it happened? What
well,
should I do with myself?
We've been friends for several years before that, but who better to counsel me in the breakup of bands than my good friend Ringo? And I have to tell you, he was so helpful to me at that time, because as he said earlier, it was very confusing. You know, you're with your friends, in some ways a family, and then you're like the proverbial fish out of water. And how do you cope? What do you do next? We certainly, in the E Street Band, had a great run. We had a lot of fun. How do you replace that fun? So it was all these questions that I was asking myself at that time, and then Ringo was very, very helpful to me.
How do you feel about the, sorry to jump cut here, electronic percussion? Ringo tells us in your book that the beat, we're human beings. There is no such thing as an absolutely digitally precise beat. So that when you're working it, you may go faster, the band will go with you, you slow down, the band will... But the, a musician, yeah, as you guys are, will recognize this. That doesn't happen electronically.
Well, I think it's our feeling that you've got to take that stick in hand and apply it. You know, and you have to propel that beat yourself. That's what it's about. It's about,
you know, it's wood on skin, or it's wood on plastic now, actually. But, you know, that's what it is. And actually, Max and myself are quite good timekeepers. I still find it hard. I mean, you do sessions today and there's a click track, and it's absolutely perfect. And so you're so busy trying to play to that, that you lose the soul of the thing. I do personally. There are some drummers who are very good at it. I personally am just not good at playing that perfect. See, this keeps time. My heart plays the time, all the time, when I play. My soul is playing the time, not some robot click track.
You had your own signature too, and you are very honest to say you never played the same number twice, even in a session.
I played the same number, I just didn't play the same fills.
Fills,
you know,
the riffs.
You know what I mean? Where I would put in my part, which, right, you know, you play the rhythm, but when you do the fill, that's where you put yourself into it.
Uh-huh.
And they would change every take.
Your style was very much the result of your being left-handed and encouraged to be otherwise by your grandmother.
Yes, she thought I was possessed by the devil.
A true story, we are certain.
Oh, yeah, true story.
Sure. So little Richie was encouraged to go to the right hand, but you still had your, I don't know, does it make you ambidextrous or just beat the drums differently?
It makes it weird. If we had two drum kits here today and we're both, we'd have them set up the same, it would be the top, the snare, the top tom, probably another tom and a floor tom, where Max would have no problems going around this way. Well, I can't do that, because he comes up with this hand, you see, so he can go around that way. Well, I come up with this hand, so I can come the other way, okay? So my fills are never very rolly. It's usually just like, dong-dong, da-dong, do-do-bop-bop, do-da. Do da 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 bum.
Yeah. And how are Max's? How are Max's?
Now, Max.
Yeah. Tell me Max's.
Max will do a roll. Take a roll, Max.
I would do it the opposite way of Ringo doing a roll. I wouldn't do it as well, probably. And I have to say, you know, that drum style that all drummers today are playing was in large measure created by what Ringo was doing. It was very, very innovative. For example, you know, you'll see old films of Ringo playing, and he'll hit the crash cymbal, the one on the left, with his left hand, where I would come across and hit it with my right. And playing those tom-tom fills that he just described, no one had ever really done that on record before. So the drummers that are drumming today, from my generation, kids younger than me, are all sort of descended from that tradition. And it may have been that that left-handed style that started that.
Mm. Thanks.
Well, Max, you're saying between us, we can't do a roll.
No.
Max, I had talked to the after a show once. I'd had a similar problem like you with your wrist. I'm just wondering how your surgery went with the wrists and if that's affecting you at all now.
Well, I did I had a particular problem with my hands, tendonitis, with Bruce Springsteen and E Street Band. Through those years, we used to play these five-hour shows, and the muscles in my hands would give out, so I'd start to squeeze the sticks real tightly, and that's something I caution musicians, anybody who swings a hammer or dentists who holds a drill, to not grip the sticks tightly. You know, again, if you watch those old films, Ringo and the drummers who were playing before big amplifiers and big sound systems were playing actually pretty softly and fairly reasonably in terms of holding the sticks. I'm a product of late 60s, 70s, real loud playing, and I would start to grip the sticks and play really hard, probably harder than I had to, and I got this this problem, which has been surgically corrected years and years ago.
Yes, but also, Max, I mean, you know, Bruce would do a five-hour show, and you do a five-hour sort of rehearsal, so you probably played more hours than six or seven regular drummers.
That's true.
Put together, I mean, you know, you really...
They were long hours.
You
and
did a lot of time there.
Yeah, well, we do five shows a day, but they were continuous. We didn't stop.
This audience, hands in the air, gets a chance to ask these their own questions when we come back in just a moment.
Over the last 30 years, music has...
Yes! Linda Mann, who sailed to sea, and he told us of his life in the land, the submarine. So we sailed up to the sun till we found the sea green. And we played beneath the waves in our yellow submarine. Let me see you now.
We all live in a yellow submarine.
Yes!
Yellow submarine, yellow submarine.
Yes. Yes,
ma'am. Hi, Ringo. I'm from India, and in the 60s, I was in my teens and a great fan of yours. You had the Beatles had a big fan following in India. Could you tell us how much you were influenced by Indian music, the Beatles as a group?
Well, of course, I got to Indian music through George. He brought it to our attention. And in the 60s, it was very good to relax to. And that's what we did.
Yes.
I would like to ask Ringo and Max, over the last 30 years, music has changed so much, and I'd like to know, what do you think of today's groups?
Go, Max.
Well, I think I'm in a particularly fortunate position playing on Late Night with Conan O'Brien, because I get to see these new groups at least three or four times a week. We present a very cutting-edge musical format on that show, and they're great. You know, it's tremendous energy. It reminds me of growing up in the 60s. It's a lot of guitar bands, which is something that I'm heavily in favor of. I like guitars. So what I get is the energy, and there's a lot of passion and commitment in the music that I'm hearing.
Yes. I couldn't have put it better.
Yes.
This question is geared towards Ringo. Do you ever associate or hear from Yoko Ono?
Occasionally.
Sure.
I mean, you know, yeah. We don't have dinner every day, and
yes.
But yes, we say hello occasionally.
She did not break up the Beatles.
No, of course she didn't.
I did. Do you want to tell the truth now? Or?
This question's directed to both you guys. There's some musicians out there that put their music before their families. How much does your music mean to you?
Well, the music for me, you see, I put all my energy and all my time into it, but I didn't have a family then. It's just something I did. I left everything else behind, and I just went for my dream and my goal, which was, you know, to play real well and to play with good musicians. And I think, you know, you were laughingly talking about the breakup of the Beatles. As the Beatles went on, of course, when I got married and I had children, so, you know, some of the energy is taken away then. And that's, like, all those things came into the fore to end the Beatles, really. Yeah. But at the beginning, I disregarded everything, really. I just wanted to play, and I wanted to play with really good players.
You can't sit in, though, can you?
Not anymore.
No, but I mean, it's too much for the...
Yeah.
You rattle the people.
Sure. It's very hard to sit in now unless you've known the people for a while. You know, just to go to a club or something and get up, suddenly they all feel like, oh, there's one of them there, you know? And so it changes the atmosphere.
Alters everything. Mm-hmm. Sir?
Yeah. I want to ask a question about the drumming. I think the focus of the Beatles is generally on the personalities of the band, the songwriting, but the musicianship, your drumming in particular, is unparalleled. On songs like She Said, Tomorrow Never Knows, that type of stuff is just amazing. What occurred to me when I was listening to my records last night and thinking about today was that your more creative and adventurous drumming is tends to be on the Lennon songs, and I was wondering, is that because of the working relationship you had with John, as opposed to Paul? And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about Paul and John's approach.
His songs were more adventurous, so we would get more adventurous. I think that's how it worked. You know, there was always more kick in his songs, and you could actually, you know, you could actually get a little crazier. And that's how it works. But it's perfectly true. His songs, a lot of them, it's more exciting, more dynamic. Mm-hmm. Also, that gave Paul and I really a good time to work together, because the bass and drums should really work together. And so that also helped, you know. It's the only way I can answer that. His songs are more adventurous, so we were more adventurous.
I wanted to ask both of you, who are your biggest influences as drummers? And, of course, other than Max, with Ringo sitting next to you, did you ever get to talk with these people about drumming?
The only influence I can really talk about is Cozy Cole. He's the only drum record I ever bought. Cozy Cole, Topsy Part 1 and 2. Where I did love to watch Gene Krupa when I was really young. Just his attitude, he was an animal. It was just really great. So those two, really.
Well, Ringo brings up Gene Krupa. It's a good analogy, because what Gene Krupa did for drumming in the 30s and 40s is what Ringo did for drummers and drumming in the 60s. Brought the spotlight onto the drummer. When I saw the Beatles on Ed Sullivan, and had been aware of recordings they made 6 months before that, but had never seen the band, I immediately went to his style and what he was doing, which to me transmitted fun. This guy was having the time of his life. And I wanted to do that too. And I'd been playing for several years at that point. Mm-hmm. So when I look at DJ Fontana, who was Elvis's drummer, was certainly, one of the seminal rock drummers and someone who I looked to. As soon as I saw Ringo play with the Beatles, I knew that there was a possibility. Maybe I could do that too.
Yeah, anyone could do it if I could do it.
Nothing.
In other words.
Nothing gives you the opportunity to showboat faster than the drum. And I just happened to, if I were a drummer, I mean, I know I'd cross the line, with the, and sooner or later, the star is going to come to me and say, ahem, we're working here. I assume this is, within the drumming community, there are people, you must look at a drummer and say, no.
Well, you know, I really understand what you're playing, because for me, you play with the singer. You know, you play with the song. And anybody who knows anything about my playing, I never do drum solos. I still don't do them to this day. Because it's never been the part that's interested me. It's holding the track together and bringing it up and bringing it down, you know. It's the subtleties of drumming that are really exciting to me. And in fact, the less you play, it's like the more you're doing, you know. Yeah. That's how I've always played, not always looked at it there for budding drummers.
You feel the same.
I feel the same way. You know, I've always played for the singer and the song. Particularly, the thing that I like to do is to make 3-minute rock songs. And you have to be concise. And no one ever did it better than Ringo.
Yeah.
I'm going to take you everywhere I go.
And we'll be back in just a moment.
Ringo, I really loved your last studio album, Time Takes Time, and I think it was definitely one of the best albums you've made. I'd just like to know if you have any plans of making a new studio album.
No, I don't have any plans right now. The plans I have now are just to do this tour, East Coast in July and the West Coast, Texas in August, and then have a holiday.
This is for Ringo and Max. Did you ever have trouble with stage fright?
Sure.
Well, you threw up, he said, at the Palladium. You know, that's an indication,
also,
I would think.
Also, every night I go on, I have to run on. I'd like to be like Sinatra, not like, hey, how you doing? But I'm afraid I've never got to that. I'm always there, and they start up, and it's like, okay, let's go. And once I get there, I'm okay. But, you know,
question
the
for both
before,
of you.
It's really nervous.
Question for both of you. What's your favorite Beatles album?
Well, after you, Max. I'm on all of them.
Probably the one that hits me emotionally the hardest is the first one. The one with the four of them on the black cover there with all those great songs.
What was that?
I don't know. Meet the Beatles?
No, I don't know.
Meet the Beatles. That's when I first became aware of the Beatles.
Right.
The White Album, Rubber Soul, you know.
I know your favorite. I know your favorite song.
What is that?
Rain.
Rain. Well, no, I like Rain because it. I only ever played drums like that on that track, and I don't know what I was possessed by, but that's the only time I played like that.
And we'll be back in just a moment.
That left-hand drum.
It's the most incredible pet stories you've ever heard.
Look at this beautiful animal.
He's our hero dog.
Next, Donahue.
Do worse than pick up this book. It's Max Weinberg's offering of some of the biggest names in percussion throughout the whole rock and roll era and before. Max Weinberg now leading his time period with Conan O'Brien, following Jay Leno and Ringo Starr, Radio City Music Hall this week.
Services provided and promotional fees paid by the following.